Hello all. Want to talk about the book, What They Don't Teach You in Harvard Business School. Let's do it. Now, I want to start off by talking about one of my favorite memes where it talks about the two books side by side, What They Don't Teach You in Harvard Business School with Everything They Teach You in Harvard Business School. And the meme states that with these two books combined, it contains all the accumulated human knowledge ever. Just so funny because like you're talking about exclusivity and whatnot. Anyway, What They Don't Teach in Harvard Business School basically talks about the soft skills needed to succeed in business and to ultimately get things done. So this touches on a lot of interesting things that we talk about a lot here with regards to productivity and how to manage your time. And then on top of that, talks about how to actually talk to people, how to actually interact with people. One of the awesome examples that are given in this book is the notion of leveling with people. If you are emailing somebody and you're talking to them as kind of like a robot or as a business, not as a person, you're going to do much worse than if you were to actually level with them and understand that they are a person too and how you can kind of work together. The best example here was when Burger King and Pepsi were trying to team up and have the exclusive soda of Burger King be Pepsi and things like that. And the leveling was, look, Burger King and Pepsi, we're already second tier next to Coca-Cola and McDonald's. So we might as well team up together and work together to kind of advance ourselves. And kind of going through these motions and leveling and understanding where people are at in their business and in their life was really helpful to kind of create this partnership, create this development in business. Another really important thing discussed in this book is your first impression. Ultimately, we hear it all the time. You're the first 30 seconds someone interacts with you is how they're going to think of you when you walk away. All these different types of kind of mantras to keep in mind. He takes it a step further by talking about how you can make a good first impression. So how do you make a good first impression? One of the most important things that even Robert Greene talks about in the 48 Laws of Power is to be unpredictable. If you do things that people are not expecting you to do, you're going to come off more important. You're going to come off more powerful. In addition to this, it's very important, maybe even while creating your first impression, to self-disclose. The more you self-disclose, the more people will trust in you kind of naturally. So a way to do this would be you're discussing something with a potential client or a potential business partner, whatever, and you kind of just naturally throw in there, oh yeah, it's my sister's birthday today. I gotta get out early because we're going to dinner for my sister's birthday. Something about family, something about personal hobby of yours, personal endeavors that you're taking. These things that are self-disclosing automatically create a bond between the client and yourself, between your business partner and yourself. You are talking to them about something that you don't talk to anyone else about. They now feel special because you're disclosing in them. You're giving them a responsibility and they're going to nurture it and they're going to give you money. Okay, another thing that they don't teach you in Harvard Business School is how to get motivated. So ultimately, if you have to find outside motivation, if you can't find motivation within yourself, you are going to have a hard time getting motivated. You're gonna have a hard time actually getting things done. So it's very important to have inside motivation. It's very important to be able to motivate yourself. Wake up, have natural motivation to do what you want to do. However, what they don't teach in Harvard Business School is that rejection can be the greatest motivator of all time. When you're door knocking, when you're cold calling, when you're trying to get deals, when you're trying to make sales, you should not be discouraged by failure. In fact, it should do the exact opposite of that and motivate you to do better next time. Okay? We all know the old adage that Edison gave us. He didn't find one way to build a light bulb. He found multiple hundreds of ways not to build a light bulb. You have to take pride in your failures and understand, okay? Understand that they are actually advancing you more than your successes. You're learning more from your failures than you are your successes, obviously. Okay, some more interesting things to take into account when you're, say, selling your product is that timing is everything. So a couple examples that were given in the text. You should always, always come back, follow up with potential clients. They want to hear from you. Unless you hear a flat out, dead, cold no, they want to hear from you. They want you to be easily accessible. The more often you're in front of somebody, the more opportunity they have to hand you money. Take advantage of that. Be visible, be in their face, okay? And continue selling. However, this goes back to getting rejected and whatnot. Don't make your feelings personal, okay? You have to understand that it's a business, it's sales, it's multiple different things that are a multifaceted situation that you're involved in, and you can't let your feelings take control of how you operate. So understanding that is also very important. In addition to all of this, understanding the timing of sales is crucial. How do you time sales? So you're always going to follow back, you're always going to follow up, you're always going to reappear, you're always going to continue selling, you're always going to be continuing to close. How do you time this properly, right? Like, do you come back 6 weeks after your first reach out? Do you come back 6 months maybe? How do you know when to follow back? How do you know when to follow up? Well, one really interesting example was iPhones, right? Everyone knows that you are going to buy another iPhone when the next one comes out. Everyone knows that you're going to buy another iPhone when the next one comes out. They don't say to you, as you're buying the latest iPhone, that you're going to buy the next one. They don't talk about that. They talk about the current one. They're talking about the current iPhone, that one that they want you to buy right now. If it were a year later, they're having a different conversation. They want you to buy the latest iPhone. They want you to buy the new iPhone, okay? However, it's not in the sales pitch, buy this iPhone so you can have it for the next year, so you can buy the next one next year. Same thing with if you're selling clock radios, okay? You're not saying, oh, it's a great device to have, just be sure that you have batteries 5 months down the line because they're gonna run out. Okay, if you're a battery salesman, sure, that's great, but you're selling clock radios. They don't need to know right then and there that the thing's gonna run out of batteries. They don't care, they don't need to know. They want that clock radio right now. You're gonna sell it to them right now. You're gonna make the sale, okay? And you're using timing to your advantage, because then 5 months down the line, you might know, hey, there's a whole territory that has clock radios that I know are gonna run out of batteries. Now, I switch gears a little bit. I stock up on batteries. I can go knock on the same doors. I know I have a market. It's like building your email list, okay, for these subscription services that you know you're always gonna have a market for. Okay, two of the final things I wanna talk about that were discussed in what they don't teach you in Harvard Business School are how to basically schedule, we talk about this all the time, and how to prevent fatigue. Okay, it's very important to prevent yourself from growing too quickly. Now, this is a good problem to have. If you have the resources and if you have the capital and the staff to actually grow too quickly, you're doing something right. However, this is a big moment where a lot of people kind of ruin it, right? So one thing to keep in mind is don't grow faster than necessary. Don't stock up on a sales team when you only have one little territory, okay, that you want to target. Understanding your own boundaries, understanding what you're good at now, and kind of mastering that niche is crucial to dominating it and then expanding from there. Okay, the best salesmen sell within their niche. That's why they're a sought after salesperson, okay? Last but not least, actually, some of the most relatable things that were discussed in this book were toward the very end, was when he was talking about dividing your work and playtime. So we talk a lot about this in Deep Work Review by Cal Newport, and he talks about literally scheduling out your entire day. Now, if you schedule out everything that's gonna be done, you always know what has to get done, when it has to get done, how much energy it's gonna take, all these different facets of actual task and time management. The big point that was drove home here is to manage your play and work time. Understand when is family time, when is work time, when are you getting things done, when are you getting administrative things done, when are you spending time with the children, things of this nature. And it all goes back to having a system in place, a trusted system that you trust, obviously, and a system that works for you. Ultimately, a lot of things that they don't teach you in Harvard Business School that seem like they should be taught, right? We should like start a class on this. Thank you very much for watching. Be sure to check out the corresponding blog post on nickcalabro.com. Now, get to work.